But that was before a man with a gun wandered in. All of this in brief, fact-heavy snatches. Given another half hour, Tina would come up with a concrete explanation for Kennedy's downshift, but it wasn't hard to conjure a reason or two in the meantime. Sex and drugs, those fabulous standbys, filled the gaps in a lot of CVs. And Ben had spent enough evenings in the city to know what was happening when the kids went off to powder their noses. At 32 and single, maybe Louise Kennedy had had enough of the work-hard, play-hard carousel. Maybe she remembered being happy doing her teacher training. It took guts to make such a change, and Ben tipped an imaginary hat to her. He'd be meeting her soon, he supposed. And a sudden lurch in his stomach, nothing to do with altitude, prompted the whisper, "If she's still alive?" Too early for negative thinking, though. The day stretched ahead of him, as immediate and intricate as the landscape unfolding below. He could fuck things up quite handily himself, without dwelling on disasters occurring in his absence. And again he reminded himself, this man asked for me by name. Whatever he wanted, he was unlikely to start before Ben arrived. The Dalek wasn't a real Dalek, though by this frayed stage that wasn't beyond possibility. The voice was human, its electronic edge simply the tang the loud hailer bestowed. "Hello in the annex. My name's Peter Falks." Wasn't this cosy? "Is everything all right in there?" Essentially, the voice, Peter Falks, was speaking to the gun, though it was clear that for the moment at least, the gun had no intention of replying.
"We'd like you to come outside now."
Sounded all right to Louise. Beside her, Judy moaned. Not in itself unusual, but in place of the usual aggrieved self-interest was the animal undertone a frightened weasel might betray. Louise said quietly,
"It's important we don't panic."
"Oh, it's all right for you,"